610 CKTB, Wednesday, December the 16th already. 11 minutes to go until 4:49. Lee in for Larry. And we're going to come back to our Uber discussion here, just from a slightly different angle and a slightly different organization than we've chatted with before. One of the big flags on the play of the conversation between Uber and the traditional taxi industry is the insurance angle. And there have been all sorts of claims and arguments and points of view about UberX drivers, whether they are or are not sufficiently insured. That seems to be one of the great big concerns from a from not only a car care perspective, but liability and all these other issues. Well, Roger Oatley is senior partner with Oatley Vigmond, and they are one of the largest public injury law firms in the province. Mr. Oatley, welcome to the program. Roger, you, in your business, obviously have been following this back-and-forth argument since the Uber thing reared its ugly head for quite some time, and sure. You must be scratching your head sometimes.
Well, I'm a great fan of Uber, but there is a point to it. There's no question, and it's something that we should all be concerned about.
Why is there such a disagreement in? I mean, isn't car insurance a pretty cut and dried thing?
Well, actually, it's a very complicated thing.
Okay.
If I am an Uber driver and I'm driving same car that I have insured for my own personal use, and if my passenger is injured because of my negligence and my passenger sues me, my insurance company will probably say that I am not insured for that claim because they didn't give me the insurance to operate my vehicle for commercial purposes. So there is a big problem. Now, the complete answer requires an understanding of the insurance that we have. Most of us who drive automobiles have an endorsement on our policy that provides us with an extra kind of coverage if we are injured by somebody who we sue and then find out that that person is uninsured. And our own policies then kick in almost like an insurance policy for the person who has injured us. But there are lots of people who don't have motor vehicle insurance, senior citizens who don't have a car and they walk everywhere and they're pedestrians and they're injured, that kind of thing. There's lots of people who don't have auto insurance, and those people, if they're injured by an Uber driver, may well find out that there's no insurance to cover them.
With this organization billing itself as a ride-sharing service, does that go any way toward alleviating that commercial vehicle designation?
Well, a court hasn't ruled on this yet, but it's not a chance that I would want to take. The best protection is to have your own insurance coverage and make sure your limits, that's the limits of the liability coverage that you have, are adequate.
In other words, that even if you're a passenger?
Even if you're a passenger. Because if a passenger and my Uber driver goes through a red light and, God forbid, I'm seriously injured, I don't want to worry about whether that Uber driver's going to be insured. I doubt that the Uber driver is insured unless he's got a commercial liability policy, and I don't think these people do. The industry, I understand, is working with Uber to try and develop what must be some sort of hybrid policy, the likes of which doesn't exist at the moment, as far as I know. A policy that will cover the Uber driver when he's using his or her vehicle for personal purposes and cover it as a commercial vehicle when he's driving somebody for hire.
Okay, so I'm going to paraphrase the Uber position a little bit. I'm certainly not a spokesman, and I can't remember their exact language. But during various permutations of this conversation, they have mentioned the fact that they support their drivers and their passengers and have liability pools of money or whatever, for the lack of a better phrase, and that they would never let a driver or a rider or any of this be liable on their own. They say they support their drivers and passengers in this way. Are you aware of any sort of official position or process that they have in place for these things?
No, I'm not. And here's the complication. In Ontario, we have a statute that makes the owner of a vehicle liable if somebody with the owner's consent causes an injury through the driver's negligence. But Uber doesn't own the vehicle that the Uber driver is operating. So I'm not sure under what sort of grounds an injured Uber passenger has the right to sue Uber directly for compensation. The only way I can think of would be suing for misrepresentation, for failing to ensure that the vehicle was insured. But there's another huge aspect to this, and that is that we have really two parallel insurance systems in Ontario. One is the insurance, part of the insurance contract that protects us from liability when somebody sues us. That's the part that kicks in when we sue someone who doesn't have insurance. But the other part of the insurance contract that is so important is what's called accident benefit coverage. And that takes care of your immediate health care needs, your medical rehabilitation expenses in the early part of your recovery. If the Uber driver doesn't have that insurance and you don't have it yourself, I don't care what Uber has said to the public about standing behind their drivers, that kind of essential coverage won't be available to you.
So what do you see next steps? Obviously, Uber is, by all things that we can see, not going away. The taxi industry is certainly, they feel that they have their insurance house in order. Where do you think this is going to flesh out at the end of the day?
Well, I'm sure municipal and provincial governments are concerned about this. Uber must be concerned about this, and I like to think positively that people of goodwill are trying to get this resolved. In the meantime, here's my advice to anybody who's going to use Uber, as I do on a regular basis. Make sure your own insurance policy has substantial liability limits that will kick in to protect you, and $1 million isn't enough. I have 10, and it's not expensive to go beyond $1 million. And number two, make sure that you purchase the optional accident benefit coverage that's available in Ontario, because starting next June, the government has just taken an axe to auto insurance coverage in Ontario, and without the optional coverage, people are going to find that they're on the short end of the stick when they need to have their medical and rehabilitation expenses paid.
Roger, thank you so much. Very, very important information. Interesting chat, and we appreciate you coming on the show.
You're welcome.
Roger Oatley, senior partner with Oatley Vigmond. Some points to ponder. Your time now is a couple before 5:58. Bonnie Hessler.